man who dies in the arms of a king. A king who weeps for the mind of another. What kind of man must that be? To move even power to tears.
But first,
1452, a child is born in a humble village called Vinci. No one imagines that this child will one day see things no human has ever seen. Machines, before metal existed. Wings, before the sky was conquered. And faces that knew more than they were allowed to show. Who was this man? Painter? Inventor? Prophet? An illegitimate son, yet within his mind lay the future. Leonardo da Vinci. The man who knew more than his own time could comprehend. The boy who studied nature. Leonardo, the son of notary Ser Piero da Vinci and a young woman named Caterina Lippi. Two worlds that were never meant to unite. Caterina soon married another man, and Leonardo stayed with his grandfather, Antonio. Surrounded by olive trees, craftsmen, and the stillness of Tuscany. In 1457, he moved into his father's household, a world of books and scholars, two worlds, and Leonardo stood between them. Never fully belonging to either. Even as a child, he was different. Open, curious, unnervingly calm. He valued order and cleanliness as if he sensed that clarity in the outer world sharpens the mind. He observed, he questioned, he wrote. Not to believe, but to understand. Among the hills and rivers, he learned to see how water falls, how birds glide, how wind moves through grass. But why does the world move the way it does? That question never left him. He recorded everything in sketches, lines, and thoughts, an archive of the world written in mirror script. Why backwards? A secret, a protection, or fear of the church's eyes? What began as childlike curiosity soon became a language only he could read. The rise of a genius. 1469, Florence, the heart of the Renaissance. A city alive with music, trade, art, and ideas. Leonardo enters the workshop of Andrea del Verrocchio, one of the most influential artists of his time. A place between alchemy and innovation. Here, statues, paintings, instruments, and geniuses are forged. But Leonardo seeks more than form. He seeks principle, not representation, but reason. In 1472, he joins the Guild of St. Luke, officially as a painter, in truth, a researcher of the unseen. 1475, the Verrocchio's Baptism of Christ. Leonardo paints the left angel, so vivid, legend says, that the master put down his brush. But Florence becomes too small, too many rules, too many eyes fixed on what should be, not what is. Once more, Leonardo tries to escape the confines through the canvas. 1481. He begins the adoration of the Magi, a swirl of movement, chaos, and vision, as if he sought to reveal the divine within human doubt, a work he left unfinished to follow a greater calling. The longer he painted, the more he felt it. Here, in this city, his horizon ends. So he set down his brush and departed. Beyond the mountains awaited a city that dreamed bigger than Florence, Milan. What he would create there would change not only art, but the very understanding of humankind. The Engineer of Life. 1482. Leonardo entered the service of Ludovico Sforza. He introduced himself not as an artist, but as an engineer. I can build bridges, plan canals, and control the flow of water. Design machines of war. He thought in mechanisms, not myths. He planned sanitary cities, organized Milan's first waste removal, and recognized the connection between filth and disease. He measured, sketched, observed, and began to see nature as a machine. 1490, the Vitruvian Man. You, the human being, are not a body having an experience in the universe. You are the universe, having an experience through a body. In circle and square, Leonardo sought the divine proportion, the hidden equation between heaven and flesh. Then, the Last Supper. 13 men. One sentence. One of you will betray me. He does not paint saints. He paints awakening, the moment when faith becomes realization. But was that all? Did Leonardo know more than theologians ever dared admit? One figure appears different, soft, almost feminine. The hidden 13th disciple? Mary Magdalene? A truth the church suppressed, or simply Leonardo's play with symbols? No one knows. The Mona Lisa. A face that never ages. A gaze that follows you wherever you stand. Some say she is the echo of all his studies, the balance of the Vitruvian Man in human form. Perhaps he did not paint a woman, but the ideal of the soul itself. The Wanderer. 1499, Milan falls, defeated by French troops. Ludovico Sforza flees, and with him, Leonardo's world collapses. He travels across Italy, Mantua, Venice, Florence. A man without a home, but not without direction. He sketches clouds, rivers, and currents. Each page an attempt to understand the world before it forgets him. What drives him? Knowledge? Or the fear of losing it? Yet the notes he wrote during these years would shake medicine and science centuries later. The Anatomist, 1508 to 1510. Leonardo opens bodies to understand life. He draws muscles, tendons, and vessels with more precision than any surgeon of his time. He identifies arteriosclerosis centuries before it was named. He sees decay and draws it with compassion. He saw what no one wanted to see, the very decay of life itself. Yet his mind remains restless. Flying machines, parachutes, diving suits, all born within his imagination. He dreams not only of flight, but of breathing beneath the water. Why did he leave so many ideas unfinished? Was it doubt? Or did he know the world was not ready? The Final Codex, 1513. Rome. Leonardo leaves Florence to serve the French crown. He lives in the Vatican, surrounded by intrigue and illness. Michelangelo triumphs. Raphael enchants. Leonardo observes, tolerated, forgotten, but never silent. The world moves on, driven by his ideas, yet unable to grasp the man behind them. His final notebooks contain drawings and riddles that still resist interpretation. What did he see in those lines that we cannot? 1516. King Francis I invites him to France. Leonardo follows, old, weary, finally free. At Clos Lucé, he orders his codices. Hundreds of pages of mirror writing, understood only centuries later. In his last days, he speaks of mirrors and light, as if searching for the source of consciousness itself. On the 2nd of May, 1519, Leonardo da Vinci dies. Legend says a king held him, but it was likely his loyal pupil, Francesco Melzi, the man who saw the future, died in the quiet arms of history. The legacy, Leonardo da Vinci, the man who united everything a human being can know and feel, art and science, imagination and calculation, observation and vision. He laid the foundations of anatomy, architecture, and flight. He saw the earth as a system of water, air, and life, an idea we now call ecology. He thought in systems, centuries before the word science existed. Neither fame nor power drove him, but curiosity, the belief that everything is connected. Perhaps that was his greatest secret. He never sought answers. He sought connections. And that is what makes him immortal. Leonardo da Vinci, the man who saw the future.